In today's lesson, I will tell you about the locative case in Polish. I will tell you when we use the locative case and how do we form words in this case. And we will focus only on the singular number. To understand when do we use this case, it's good first to look at the name. In Polish, the locative case is miejscownik. Miejscownik. And this word comes from the word miejsce. Miejsce. And this word means a place. And this shows what is one of the functions of this case. It is used to describe places in some way. Right? So, in short, we use the locative case in order to describe a location, but also time or a topic of speech, but only after certain prepositions. So we need a preposition in addition before the word in the locative case. And these prepositions are following. Przy, which means by something. W, or we, meaning in something, in a place. Na, meaning on. Po, meaning on a surface, or after. O, meaning about. But they have more meanings than the ones I showed you. I will describe these prepositions in detail in the next slide. And a good to know is that we use the locative case after these prepositions. So if you see przy, always the next word after it will be in the locative case. But the remaining prepositions, if you see them, they very often are linked to the locative case, but sometimes they might be linked to other cases as well, depending on the context. But I will tell you more about these prepositions in the next slide. Let's start with the first preposition, przy. Przy. So after przy, we can only use a word in the locative case. And przy means nearby, near something, or it can also mean in the presence of something or someone. So it's mainly used to describe a location, so something is near something, but sometimes also some situations, some circumstances. Let's see examples. Siedzimy przy stole. We are sitting at the table. Przy stole. At the table, near the table, that means. Siedzimy przy stole. Siedzimy przy stole. So in this sentence, stole is a word in the locative case because it's after the preposition przy and also it describes a location. Siedzimy przy stole. Another example, usiądź przy oknie. Sit by the window. Usiądź przy oknie. Usiądź przy oknie. Or nie baw się telefonem przy jedzeniu. Don't play with your phone while eating. So here is a situation, while, during, in the presence of. Nie baw się telefonem przy jedzeniu. Nie baw się telefonem przy jedzeniu. Nie pal przy mnie. Don't smoke in my presence. Nie pal przy mnie. Nie pal przy mnie. In all these sentences, we had the preposition przy, near or meaning near or in the presence of something, and the next word was in the locative case. Stole, oknie, jedzeniu, mnie. These are all words in red in the locative case. Then also we use the locative case after the preposition w. W means in something, in a place. Or There is another variant of this word, of this preposition, ve, ve. So in addition, have this e sound. Ve is used when we want to make it easier to pronounce. Sometimes certain combinations of consonants at the beginning of the word might make it difficult to pronounce, so then we use ve. And here it is used to describe a location, but a static location, so when there is no movement, but also to describe time. And here are some examples. Ona mieszka w Polsce. She lives in Poland. Ona mieszka w Polsce. So w Polsce means in Poland. W Polsce, but quickly when we pronounce as w Polsce, w Polsce. Yeah? Polsce is a word in the locative case. But if you had a sentence, ona mieszka we Francji, she lives in France, then we have we Francji, in France. Here we have we, we, this variant of the preposition, to make it easier to pronounce, we Francji, because Francji, it would be too difficult, I guess, to pronounce and make it clear what we want to say. So we say we Francji. Or another sentence, this time expressing time. W grudniu pada śnieg. In December, it snows. W grudniu pada śnieg. W grudniu pada śnieg. Here we have w grudniu. Quickly, w grudniu. W grudniu. And grudniu is in the locative case. Right, so we can express place. W Polsce, we Francji, or time, w grudniu. But note that whenever we have a dynamic situation, some movement, and we answer the question where to, then we won't use the locative case, we will use the accusative case. And also when we tell the days of the week specifically, we will use the accusative case. So this is also good to know. For example, skręć w prawą stronę. Turn right or turn to the right side. Skręć w prawą stronę. Here, prawą stronę is accusative case. The accusative case because we have some movement. Where to we are going to. Or when we tell what is the day of the week, we use the accusative case, like here, w sobotę nie pracuję. I don't work on Saturday. W sobotę nie pracuję. So, w sobotę means on Saturday. It's in the accusative case. Good. Then, the next preposition after which we will use the locative case is na. Na. And this one means on a surface. And here again, when we describe the static location, we will use the locative case. But also na can be used when we want to describe some situation, some events, or when we tell that we play on an instrument. That's also the time to use the this preposition na and the locative case. And examples would be following. Siedzę na krześle. I am sitting on a chair. Siedzę na krześle. Siedzę na krześle. Right? Na means on a surface. And krześle is a word in the locative case. Na krześle. Jestem na spotkaniu. I am in a meeting. I am at a meeting. Jestem na spotkaniu. Na spotkaniu means on a meeting. On a meeting or in a meeting, at a meeting. And here we mean that we are taking part in this gathering. Jestem na spotkaniu. Or gram na gitarze. I play the guitar or I'm playing the guitar can also mean gram na gitarze. Gram na gitarze. So whenever we have a static location described or an event, a situation, or when we tell that we play an instrument, we use na and then the word in the locative case. But when we describe some movement and we answer the question where to, then we will use the accusative case instead of the locative case, same as it was in the previous situation, in the previous slide. So, for example, you will say idę na spotkanie. I'm going to a meeting. We will use the accusative case in Polish. Na spotkanie. Idę na spotkanie. That's how it would be. Another preposition that will be linked to a word in the locative case is po. Po means on, or around, or after. It has many meanings. And this is used when we want to describe a static location, or when we want to tell what is the origin of something. And it can also be used to express time. For example, nie chodź po mokrej podłodze. Don't walk on the wet floor. Nie chodź po mokrej podłodze. Po means on or on the surface, here and there, around this place, this area. And mokrej podłodze is the word in the locative case. Nie chodź po mokrej podłodze. Or ona dostała imię po babci. She got her first name after her grandma. Ona dostała imię po babci. Po means after, so that's when we want to show the origin of this name. And babci is grandma. Ona dostała imię po babci. Or to express time, for example, here is an example. Zadzwoń do mnie po pracy. Call me after work. Zadzwoń do mnie po pracy. Zadzwoń do mnie po pracy. So here you can see different situations when we use po and the next word is in the locative case. But if we are answering the question where to, again, we are showing some movement and describing a target. We are trying to reach something. Then we will use the accusative case after po. For example, idź do sklepu po gazetę. Go to the store to get the newspaper. Idź do sklepu po gazetę. Po gazetę is mean for the newspaper, to get the newspaper. We are describing our target, our thing that we are trying to reach and get. And one more thing about this po. We also won't use the locative case after po when we are describing the way we are doing things or when we tell what kind of language we speak. Then in this situation, it's not the locative case, but it's the dative case with the u ending. For example, zrobię to po swojemu. I will do it my way, or like in my way. Zrobię to po swojemu. Or mówię po polsku. I speak Polish. Mówię po polsku. Here we have po polsku. It's not the locative case. Here we have a special old form, archaic form. It's the dative case, po polsku. Right? So here in these examples, we don't have the locative case. We are describing the way of doing things and the language we speak. Moving forward, we have also the preposition o, meaning about or at. And after that, we use the locative case to describe the topic of speech. So like about something, we are talking about something, or in some time expressions as well. Here are examples. To jest piosenka o miłości. This is a song about love. To jest piosenka o miłości. So, o miłości is about love. That's the topic of what is the song about. So it can be a topic of what we talk about, but also something is about something. To jest piosenka o miłości. Or to express time, we can use also o. For example, spotkajmy się o godzinie ósmej. Let's meet at 8 o'clock. Spotkajmy się o godzinie ósmej. Spotkajmy się o godzinie ósmej. We can also say that in short. Spotkajmy się o ósmej. Let's meet at 8. Simply, we don't need the godzinie here. And thing to remember is that sometimes we will use the accusative case after o, and it will be mainly when we want to request something, and there is more dynamic verbs. For example, zapytam sprzedawcę o cenę. I will ask the salesperson about the price. So we have o cenę here, about the price, but here it's more like our request. This is not the discussion we are having. We are not discussing about the price, but this is a sentence in which we are defining what is the target, what we are trying to request and get. Here it's more dynamic movement or situation. So as you can see, there are a few prepositions that are linked to the locative case. And now let's see how to form the words in the locative case. How do they look? What are the typical endings or alternations in the words? And I will cover only the singular number. Let's start with the nouns. When we have masculine and neuter nouns, we can have two possible endings in the locative case. One of the possible endings can be a. And this will be used whenever we have the basic form ending with a hard consonant, or most of the hard consonants. And here I listed these. So if we have b, d, f, w, m, n, p, r, s, t, v, z, when we have a hard consonant, one of these listed, then after that we will have a. But in addition, you can see this apostrophe. This is a symbol that something will happen. There will be an alternation. So the change, a physical change that happens here, is that we move the tongue up. So b becomes b, p, p, f, fi, v, vi, m, mi, n, ni, s, sh, z, j, t, ch, d, j, w, l, and r, j. These are the changes that will happen in addition to adding the a. But let's see examples so you get the idea more. We have the word sklep. Sklep means a store. And this word ends in p, p. Sklep. We have the at the end. And p is listed here. It means that this is a consonant, a hard consonant, after which we will add this a. And in addition, we will make this alternation. So what will happen? We will have sklepi a. So we have this e, p, instead of p, skle, pie, Sklepie will be the form in the locative case. Another one, okno. Okno, a window. This time this is a neuter word. And we have the n consonant here. It's not the final letter, but this is the final consonant. O is the next one. But if we look at the consonant, n is the at the end. And n is the hard consonant listed, which means that we need to make the alternation to ni, n becomes ni, and then add a. Okno becomes oknie, oknie. Or autobus. We have s at the end, autobus. And this means a bus. And the alternation will be s to sh. And then a jumps in, which makes autobusie, autobusie. Kot, a cat. We have t at the end. And this is one of the consonants. And what will happen is koce. T becomes ch. And then we put a koce, koce. Samochód, a car. We have d at the end. So again, some alternations will happen. Samochodzie. Samochodzie. But in addition, we have another alternation. U becomes O. And this alternation is quite common, not only in the locative case. Or another word, stół. We have W at the end. This means a table. And what happens? W becomes L. And then comes A. Stół, stole. And again, in addition, we see this vowel alternation. U becomes O, which is common in other cases as well. Jezioro. Here, R is the last consonant. It means a lake, and jeziorze will be in the locative case. R becomes Ż. Okay, but then we have another possible ending for masculine and neuter words. And this is U. So basically, this is the other consonants that were not listed in the previous one. And here I listed these. So this is K, G, H. These are actually hard consonants, but they are also in this group. And some soft or historically soft consonants, which are C, Z, Č, Ž, Š, Ž, Č, Ž, Ni, Š, Ž, I, L. After these, we will add U. But the good news, we won't have any alternation, so straight we attach this U. And for example, pociąg, a train, in the locative case will be pociągu, pociągu, right? Nothing changes apart from adding this U. Dziecko, a child. This is a neuter noun, and we have k as the final consonant. So we add the U, which makes dziecku. O changes to U, dziecku. Dach, a roof. H is at the end, so it will be dachu. Morze, a sea. We have Ż as the final consonant, and it will become morzu. Koń, a horse, and we have a ni, and in the locative case it will be koniu. And as you can see, when saying koniu, we don't anymore have this ni with this acute sign. This is because in Polish, whenever we put a vowel after this letter, it changes the way we write. So ni becomes n, n-i written. It's pronounced basically the same, but it's written differently because of the fact that we have a vowel after that. That's how it is. And just to mention, there are some irregular words, exceptions. After dom, pan, syn, although we have m and n at the end, still we add u. So according to the rules, we would say, we would add e, but these are exceptions and we add the second ending to these words. So good to remember these. These are quite often used. Okay, and then when we're talking about feminine words and masculine words ending in a that actually have the same declension as feminine words, they can have following endings. One of the endings can be a, which is similar as it was with the masculine and neuter words. So it happens the same with the feminine words. And in addition, you can also see this apostrophe, meaning that, there are also alternations. However, if you look closer, there is a difference. We have more consonants, more hard consonants, after which we will put this a. I made those in bold. So in addition to the ones that were in the previous slide, we can have g, h, k listed here. So in addition, these three consonants will require to have a ending in the feminine gender of nouns. And we need to remember about the alternations. You can see them how it will be. But let's maybe just move straight to the example so you see how it works. For example, we have the word mama, which means mom, and this is a feminine word. And we can see that m is the last consonant in the word. M, a will be the vowel, so we don't count that. But as a consonant, it's m. And m is listed here, which means that according to the rules, we need to add a. Ma. Mm. But instead of just putting a at the end, we need this alternation and m will become mi. Ma, mie. Mamie will be in the locative case. Tata, dad, has t as the final consonant, and here we have the change t to ch, and then comes a, tacie, tacie. Szkoła, school, we have w, szkoła, szkoła. What happens is change the w to l, and then add e. And we have szkole. Polska, Poland, we have k, and the changes k to change to c, and the word will be polsce, polsce. Kolega, a friend, will be koledze. Mężczyzna will be mężczyźnie. And the second possible ending is y. This is used after the historically soft consonants, so-called, which are in specific c, z, czy, dż, sz, zż. So after these, we will use y. For example, kierowca, we have c, and then it makes kierowcy, kierowcy. Mysz, a mouse, will be myszy. And the last possible ending for feminine words will be i. This will be used after soft consonants, ci, ji, ni, si, ji, i, and in addition the historically soft l. For example, ciocia, an aunt. Then we will have cioci, cioci. So a disappears totally. Pani, madam, lady, it will be pani in the locative case. So it looks the same. Jola, that's a female name, and it will be joli. Or lekcja, a lesson, it will be lekcji. But this is quite complex, as you could see. Different endings for the masculine and neuter nouns, and the same for feminine, lots of consonants. How can you even remember all of this? Here are some tips that might help you remember. Whenever we have so many rules, one of the best methods to learn grammar is simply get familiar with many, many examples. So read a lot, analyze a lot. This will give you a possibility to see the patterns. You will kind of feel the rhythm that simply this fits, this ending fits here, nothing else. And what might help you is remember one example for each scenario. For example, you can remember that words ending in ga, like kolega, that's, you can remember kolega as your selected word, and that in the locative case is koledze, kolega becomes koledze. Then when you see similar words like podłoga, it feels natural to say podłodze, noga, nodze. Then when following the pattern, the new words you will see with the same ending, it will be natural for you, automatic, to say this ending that was used in the word you remembered. Or what I can also tell that helps is to practice a lot. Do many exercises and in specific, create your own examples, own sentences. For example, you can describe your room because the locative case is used to when describing places. So try to describe, be personal when creating the sentences. This will help you feel that this is important, relates to you, it's very practical and more convincing. And then moving forward, if we look at the adjectives, how do adjectives look in the locative case? It's quite straightforward and not so complex. Masculine and neuter adjectives will have the im and im ending. Im will be after k and g. For example, dobry will be dobrym, wysoki will be wysokim. And feminine words will have the a ending or je after k and g in the locative case. Dobra will be dobrej, wysoka, for example, wysokie. Yeah, and that's it if we talk about the adjectives. And to summarize, you can have a look at this slide and analyze the different endings that are used in the locative case in the singular number for nouns and adjectives. This might help you see everything at a glance. And one more thing, good to remember about special forms. So the word kto means who will have the form kim in the locative case, kim. Co, meaning what, will be czym. Ten, but also to, meaning this, will be tym. And for personal pronouns, ja will be mnie. Ty will be tobie, on or ono will be nim, and ona will be niej. These are these pronouns that it's good to remember. And as mentioned before, one of the best ways to learn different grammatical forms, especially when there are a lot of rules, is getting familiar with many examples. So you will start to feel these forms and see how it works and convince your mind that this makes sense in a way. So what I will do now, I will read the many examples, try to think why this word in red is in the locative case. So think of what is the function. And then you can think also why this or that ending I put here. On mieszka w Ameryce. He lives in America. On mieszka w Ameryce. On mieszka w Ameryce. Ona mieszka w Europie. She lives in Europe. Ona mieszka w Europie. Ona mieszka w Europie. Oni mieszkają w Kanadzie. They live in Canada. Oni mieszkają w Kanadzie. Oni mieszkają w Kanadzie. Mieszkacie w Wielkiej Brytanii? Do you live in Great Britain? Mieszkacie w Wielkiej Brytanii? Mieszkacie w Wielkiej Brytanii? Nigdy nie byłam we Francji. I have never been to France. Nigdy nie byłam we Francji. Nigdy nie byłam we Francji. W styczniu będę w Londynie. In January, I will be in London. W styczniu będę w Londynie. W styczniu będę w Londynie. W marcu będę w Nowym Jorku. In March, I will be in New York. W marcu będę w Nowym Jorku. W marcu będę w Nowym Jorku. W przyszłym roku będę w drugiej klasie. Next year, I will be in second grade. W przyszłym roku będę w drugiej klasie. W przyszłym roku będę w drugiej klasie. W tym tygodniu nie będę w pracy. This week I won't be at work. W tym tygodniu nie będę w pracy. W tym tygodniu nie będę w pracy. W zeszłym miesiącu byłam w bibliotece. Last month I was in the library. W zeszłym miesiącu byłam w bibliotece. W zeszłym miesiącu byłam w bibliotece. W sklepie jest jedzenie. There is food in the store. Or literally, in the store is food. W sklepie jest jedzenie. W sklepie jest jedzenie. W szkole są dzieci. There are children in the school. W szkole są dzieci. W szkole są dzieci. W parku są drzewa. There are trees in the park. W parku są drzewa. W parku są drzewa. W pokoju nie ma łóżka. There is no bed in the room. W pokoju nie ma łóżka. W pokoju nie ma łóżka. Ktoś jest w twoim domu. There is someone in your house. Ktoś jest w twoim domu. Ktoś jest w twoim domu. Na podłodze leży dywan. There is a carpet on the floor. Na podłodze leży dywan. Na podłodze leży dywan. Na dywanie leży kot. There is a cat on the carpet. Na dywanie leży kot. Na dywanie leży kot. Na stole leży książka. There is a book on the table. Na stole leży książka. Na stole leży książka. Na książce leży telefon. There is a phone on the book. Na książce leży telefon. Na książce leży telefon. Co będziesz robić na urlopie? What are you going to do on vacation? Co będziesz robić na urlopie? Co będziesz robić na urlopie? Umiesz grać na instrumencie? Do you know how to play an instrument? Umiesz grać na instrumencie? Umiesz grać na instrumencie? Umiem grać na pianinie. I know how to play the piano. Umiem grać na pianinie. Umiem grać na pianinie. Kto gra na perkusji? Who plays the drums? Kto gra na perkusji? Kto gra na perkusji? Ona gra na komputerze. She plays on the computer. Ona gra na komputerze. Umiesz jeździć na rowerze? Do you know how to ride a bike? Umiesz jeździć na rowerze? Umiesz jeździć na rowerze? Ktoś chodzi po dachu. Someone is walking on the roof. Ktoś chodzi po dachu. Ktoś chodzi po dachu. Po ścianie chodzi pająk. There is a spider walking on the wall. Po ścianie chodzi pająk. Po ścianie chodzi pająk. Po śniadaniu myję zęby. After breakfast, I brush my teeth. Po śniadaniu myję zęby. Po śniadaniu myję zęby. Co robisz po południu? What are you doing in the afternoon? Or literally, what are you doing after noon? Co robisz po południu? Co robisz po południu? Chodzę spać po 10. I go to bed after 10. Or I go to sleep after 10. Chodzę spać po 10. Chodzę spać po 10. Siedzę przy wejściu. I am sitting at the entrance. Siedzę przy wejściu. Siedzę przy wejściu. Usiądź przy stole. Sit at the table. Usiądź przy stole. Usiądź przy stole. Nie stój tak przy ścianie. Don't just stand there by the wall. Nie stój tak przy ścianie. Nie stój tak przy ścianie. Nie czytaj przy jedzeniu. Don't read while eating. Nie czytaj przy jedzeniu. Nie czytaj przy jedzeniu. O czym myślisz? What are you thinking about? O czym myślisz? O czym myślisz? Myślę o tym filmie. I'm thinking about the film. Myślę o tym filmie. Myślę o tym filmie. O kim rozmawiacie? Who are you talking about? O kim rozmawiacie? O kim rozmawiacie? Rozmawiamy o Januszu. We are talking about Janusz. Rozmawiamy o Januszu. Rozmawiamy o Januszu. Wstaję o 8. I get up at 8. Wstaję o 8. Wstaję o 8. Usiądź przy mnie. Sit next to me. Usiądź przy mnie. Usiądź przy mnie. Oni myślą o tobie. They are thinking about you. Oni myślą o tobie. Oni myślą o tobie. Nie zapomnij o nim. Don't forget about him. Nie zapomnij o nim. Nie zapomnij o nim. Co wiesz o niej? What do you know about her? Co wiesz o niej? Co wiesz o niej? All right, and these would be all of my examples with words in the locative case. I hope that this video helped you understand when do we use the locative case and how words look like in this case. Thank you for watching. Until next time.